Dear colleagues, good morning and welcome to day 3 of our conference and to its last session. I hope you all slept well and had a decent breakfast in your hotels. Time has come to ask what has been done so far on the field of processing and using biographical data. A variety of projects will be presented to us. And I'm really curious and looking forward to your practical achievements in this field and the following discussions. As our first speaker lecturer, I welcome Milena Dobreva. She obtained her PhD in informatics in 1999 at the Bulgarian Academy of Science and Digitization of Cultural Heritage. In 2004, she served as the founding head of the first digitization center in Bulgaria. After many years in Scotland, she became associate professor at the University of Malta in 2012. Here she established a master's course in documentary heritage and militensia. She regularly evaluates programs in the field of e-infrastructures and digital humanities for the European Commission. Milena, we look forward to your lecture about how to index biographical data from archival documents using the methods of the citizen science.
Thank you and good morning to everyone who made it today. I want to start with a sort of a caveat. I'm not presenting any particular project which actually develops personal indexes of personal data, but in the last couple of years I was involved in a project which was working on a roadmap in the area of citizen science in the humanities. Obviously, when you are involved in such a project, you learn a lot about different initiatives, and my talk is more provocative. It's more on the edge of what can be done. I will give some examples and I was not instructed how to use the clicker. So here we are with the bright presence of the co-op project, which helps to bring different silos together. And when we speak about silos, it's not only in the sense of different institutions and their collections, but also in the sense of different user communities. So I thought that this historical photo from 41 actually captures some of the spirit of what we were experiencing here in the last days. In my talk, I will talk briefly about what is citizen science. Since there is a lot of confusion with crowdsourcing, I will try to explain what are the differences. Then we will contemplate a bit why it's not so popular in the area of memory institutions and humanities research compared to the sciences. Even the name citizen science seems to be off-putting because it creates this science link, especially for the people from the English-speaking part. This is a very, very serious terminological issue. Then we will look at some of the specific tasks which can benefit from citizen science. And I'm very interested in what hybrid models are arising and how they combine automated methods, we heard a lot about this yesterday, with the human contributions. So let's start with citizen science. Citizen science is this area of involving the general public in research, which is led by academics, which meets several important conditions. First of all, we have people who are not professional researchers. Second, this is a voluntary participation, which means that it's very important what is the intrinsic motivation of these people. If they are not interested in what they do, they will never come to contribute to the specific tasks you're offering them. Although the intrinsic motivation is very important, we will see that in the area of memory institutions, people are mostly prompted to do some data entry or data collection. I don't know to what extent these tasks are motivating for lots of people, but it seems that in a number of occasions we have good examples of successful projects. Crowdsourcing is just one of the possible methods to involve people. In some cases, we could have small research projects where we have individual contributions or contributions of small groups of people. We have such examples in Malta. I'm not going in depth there, but it's not necessary that you involve huge crowds, although these days we move towards huge data sets and volumes of data. On the other hand, the indexing task and the creating of different helpful auxiliary tools is quite a different type of fish. So we have structured data. We saw yesterday many examples of different databases which were developed by different projects, ad hoc mostly. These days, the task of presenting data moves to a semantic web to linked open data, and there is the EAC CPF standard, which was developed and enjoys adoption in different institutions. We have in this case extracts rather than full text or big models of different objects. We have the quality control of professionals, and currently we can see that there is a lot going on in the area of prosopography and the interesting task of merging lists which have different provenance, either come from the work of different individual researchers or different sources. So here we have a lot about structure, we have a lot about control of quality. So how this could merge with the contribution of people who are not really trained to do such tasks? In a nutshell, we are also living in times when research is changing. Now we move, we slide towards open research, which means that we not only provide for free access to our research outcomes and research data, but we also involve openly bigger communities. The whole emphasis on big data and vast resources, which we saw in the last days, is something which obviously needs to be taken into account. There is always the question how we are going to produce our data, what amount of mistakes this generates. Yesterday, Dr. Robert made a very nice comment that if we involve human, this doesn't mean that we go mistake-free. It's just a different sort of framework and different timelines, obviously. And what I think is quite fascinating is that the science seems to change from this paradigm of standing on the shoulders of giants to picking the brains of giants, and not only giants. Everyone who is keen to contribute is welcome to do so these days. And obviously for within the context of a memory institution where the quality of the output is essential, especially for specific types of outputs, this is quite a serious thing. A very quick historical example, which I chose in this case because it generates a wonderful archive. I'm sure that the people from the Reed Consortium would really love to have their hands on all the slips from 800 volunteers. This is how the Oxford English Dictionary was started, since tasks were immense. The public was invited to contribute, and this was quite successful. Within 1 year, about 800 volunteers contributed 3.5 million quotation slips, and we see here St. James Murray and part of his archive. So this is one of the early examples of such initiatives. There are lots of them. There is a project currently on the way, coordinated by the Oxford University, which compares the citizen science practices in the 19th century and today. Obviously, today we have the benefit of the mobile technologies which link people fast. However, in our domain, in the area of humanities and, let's say, arts, the uptake, as I already mentioned, is not that great. Here I present data from one particular crowdsourcing platform, and these are the data of different mini-projects implemented there across disciplines. Science on the right is the most popular area, and the humanities are almost in the left corner with very few projects going on. So this illustrates that there are still some stumbling blocks and not everyone is convinced that it is something good to do. I will give now a few examples. I will not talk about transcribing Bantam because we saw a wonderful presentation on the first day of the conference. I'm also not going to talk about the project of the Genealogical Society, which is going to be presented just right after me. What I wanted to give you is a taste of different tasks, different relationships with the contributors, different platforms. I'll start with this project, The Letters of 1916, an Irish project which combined in a nice way material from memory institutions and the call to volunteers to not only transcribe those letters but also to add their own letters, letters from their personal collections, which were written in this year. The aim is to create a rich resource which would be used by historians. It was a year of many important events in the Irish history. Mm-hmm. And the way of looking at it from the point of view of the people who lived in that time and left their trace in correspondence actually motivates the project. The transcription followed also an encoding. I mean, it was combined with the encoding using TEI. So here we come with the data about persons, which become identifiable in the process of this transcription. But it's not a project where we use an existing set of data about persons from that time, because, again, here we speak about a very big variety of different people, not only prominent personalities who lived in that time. Another example is on georeferencing maps, a famous one from the British Library. You would say that it has nothing to do with persons, but georeferencing is definitely relevant when we also create a different database about the life of people. So having a historical map resource is something which is useful. The table I provided was showing how many different contributions are coming from various volunteers. Another example of a project which resides on History Pin is the Year of the Bay. This one is framed as historical mystery. So there is a set of photographs, and basically the challenge is to recognize what is this building, where was it located exactly, and again to pin it to the map of the area. So you can see that 185 mysteries were on the menu, and quite a few were already resolved, but there are several which wait for people who would be able to find out more about the buildings. And another example is related to the Holocaust Memorial Museum. This is aiming to find information about what happened to different children from the ghetto in Lodz. There were records about those children who attended the school in the ghetto, but there is no further information on many of those children. As you can see, there are over 10,000 students with currently unknown fate. But after the platform was created, gradually some of these stories are unveiled, and some of the children on the photographs are being identified with the help of people who still can find some information. Now I have a little video from the last example, which comes from Wales. I basically chose it because it reminded me part of the tasks which were given nice examples for the Read Consortium yesterday. So here we have a resource which includes data on land in Wales. And this is the tool which is used to actually transcribe the data. There are also huge maps. They're so big that no scanner size can take them. So they were digitized, actually making photographs segment by segment. And this illustration shows the tool which not only is used to transcribe the data, but also to point which part of the land registry actually they represent. And here we see the digitized map where the user can afterwards make a connection of the transcribed data on persons with the particular plot of land. It's not exactly identical to what we have seen, but in a way it's a nice illustration of a combination of different aspects of what had been discussed. So I hope that this gave you a taste about different tasks, different approaches, and the feeling that there are also quite a few platforms which are developed for specific projects. When we see how the projects look like, actually we find that they had the resource to develop their own crowd attraction platform, and also they had a very clearly identified goals. So let me move to the next part, how this relates to us in the archives. In the area of citizen science, Bonny and his co-authors defined three models of participation. One is contributory, which is actually with the smallest range of tasks implemented by the users. The next one is collaborative, where they feel collaborators and are involved in more tasks. And the most, let's say, fully fledged way of participation is co-creation, creating joint projects with academics and family institutions. In our domain, we are mostly on the levels of contributory and collaborative projects, but probably over time we will see more co-created projects where communities point towards questions which are of interest to them. So instead of asking people to transcribe something, probably we will see more and more examples of people saying, let's put together data around this topic. Previous research on citizen science showed that it's a great way to raise interest in our research domains. There is an educational aspect, people learn how to do different things, they are being trained. In the area of sciences, that's also a way to get cheap or free labor. You can find articles about research in astrophysics where there is an estimate how the citizen contribution saved so many years of a researcher time, so you can put a tag price on this type of contribution. In the memory institutions, actually, we see something different. The amount of effort to start and run a project means that there are staff members which are heavily involved in it. So the contribution sometimes is actually difficult to be framed as something which saves a lot of money to the institution. More, it is seen as an interesting way to engage people in something which they like. So there is also the everlasting argument to show people that their tax money are used in good initiatives. Something which is quite interesting, based on the research of Andrea Wiggins and Kevin Crosten, one can see that projects which are set as citizen science projects seem to be over-optimistic. They have higher expectations compared to what actually is delivered in the end. In the left we see the expectations, and on the right we see the actual outcomes. But the situation is not tragic. It's always with all sorts of projects that they cannot be 100% successful. One key issue which still is not very clear in our domain is the data ownership. Again, based on Andrea Wiggins, one is quite impressed to see that many projects don't have any data policy at all. Obviously, in our domain, where we will have to mix different sources of data, this will be quite important. The project in which I was involved looked at the technological tools which are used in this area, and we made a comparison with the earlier findings of Wiggins. Basically, we looked at cultural heritage institutions, so we find that there is a difference in the tools, and especially there is a difference in the tools which are reported to be lacking. For example, in our study, we could see that semantic annotation tools and real-time 3D visualization tools are tools which cultural institutions feel would help them to start and involve people in citizen science, but they lack good support with them. So what I wanted to illustrate is that in our area, the need of specific tools is there. It's great that projects like Reed work on probably tools which will spin off and will be used in citizen science context. We can also contemplate where citizen science falls if we look at this dichotomy of pure and basic research. It's just a bit of a teaser for you. And let me move towards some conclusive remarks. So we have a number of challenges which need to be overcome. The challenge of matching projects and people. There are existing communities which contribute to crowdsourcing projects, which can be attracted for similar tasks. But that's one of the interesting things which needs to be done by anyone who starts something. The division of labor and the integration of contributions along these three participatory models is also something which is quite exploratory at the moment, especially in the area of co-creation. The platforms which are used and their interoperability with other tools. We talked a lot about silo cultures in the past. We are going to create a silo culture also in the citizen participation if there are so many different platforms for different projects and goals. There is the big issue of trusting citizens' contributions and the control of quality. I'm sure that the next presentation will cover this aspect. A colleague from New Zealand, Gillian Oliver, is currently doing research around this topic. So probably the next year we will see some of her findings. The motivation of people who are contributing is very important. It can fluctuate, so basically if we attract people, we want to keep them interested and we need to maintain communication with them. What the citizens gain in terms of domain literacy is quite important. And there are a lot of practical issues. So as I said in the beginning, I expect that in the future, in this community, there will be many new initiatives which will illustrate in a good way the strength of citizen science. Some links to useful outcomes of our project, civic epistemologies. There is a link to the roadmap, to a registry of tools which exist in this domain, and also the project concluded with something which is called the Berlin Charter. Everyone who is interested in this area can join it, which means that they will be updated in the future on new developments in this domain. So again, something which happened here in Germany at the final conference of the project last year in November. I know that the presentations will be distributed, so it will be easy to follow these links. So in a summary mode, we see that there are different tools. The academic involvement is a very interesting aspect, to what extent we can formulate research projects. The tasks of the, especially the indexing task, might be made interesting in the paradigm of finding Waldo. So I mentioned several examples which didn't aim specifically to collect prosopographic information, but people come across bits and pieces, and we will face the task of putting all these together. What are the possible scenarios of citizen science to collaborate with the archives? I think that there are different options, and having in mind that the last estimate of Europeana was that only about 10% of the cultural heritage material in Europe is digitized, which by no means means that it's available in full text and in well-structured data sets. There is a lot to do, obviously. There is a lot to do in digitization. There is a lot to do in better access to this 10% of digitized content. So we can see a whole range of opportunities from competition, where the people who are developing automated tools say, we will work on this, we will increase constantly the precision of our tools, the quality of our output, so we don't need any contribution of any real people. I don't think that this is very realistic, so I think that we will move along this scale of facilitation, interpretation of data which are acquired in an automated way, and complementarity. Maybe one way we will see also strategic partnerships. And if we think about the famous Pareto principle, where 20% of the effort generate 80% of the outcome, and now we discuss a lot of scenarios where 80% of the effort lead to small improvements. I think that this could be a good starting point to think how we can mix and match the citizen science with automated tools. I'm really pleased that this conference took place, and these communities of people from the archives and various automated tools which can improve the accessibility are here together, because also in the paradigm of citizen science it's important to define who will finance what. So basically, I'm concluding with this. What will happen when we mix together citizen contributions, automated text recognition, and prosopographic resources? Them are still not properly mixed. And probably in the next meeting, we will start seeing different types of mixtures and different outcomes. So maybe somebody will come with something which is like a latte, and another project will come with something which is like a double espresso mochaccino with a lot of froth and other additives. But I think that we all will have to rethink when we have our resources. What do we have? How much we can do using automated tools? Where the automated tools cannot really bring us where we want to be from the point of view of what we offer to our communities? And I think that this promises to all of us in this room an exciting future with new opportunities. So thanks for your attention. And as I said, the presentation will be shared somewhere.
Yeah, thank you very much for this insight in the development of citizen science, which is to me very new and somewhat fascinating. My question to the audience is, are there any questions or comments for Milena, please?
Thank you very much. That was a really fascinating talk. I would like to ask you, there are some other technical terms in use. A very common technical term is crowdsourcing. A less common term is community sourcing. But where would you draw the boundaries between these terms?
Thank you. That's interesting. And I was mentioning that we will move towards more questions which come from our communities. I think that probably this is one of the interesting aspects of using multiple contributions in our domains. In fact, when this happens, we always have some community which is interested. If we take the example of transcribing Bentham, and I'm sure that the next presentation will talk about this, we have people who are interested. They don't have financial incentive, so in a way they're a community. This might be a dispersed community in the sense that it's not coming together, but maybe this could be one of the outcomes of such initiative to bring this community also in the physical world. Because if people are interested in the same type of material or the same topic, probably they would enjoy having an opportunity to meet and discuss.
Perhaps you later on will see what is possible is community sourcing, because that's what we do. But I think that it's community sourcing, crowdsourcing can fill each other, because it can be totally different, but also is a grey area. And what we have to try, I think, is to fill the gap between those two and let it be a grey area, because it's not completely different. But perhaps later on you will see what is community sourcing, and it's already very that's given a lot of results. But with crowdsourcing, you can have enormous results, and I think you have to do both.
If I could add a little comment, we seem to be in an area where the whole terminology is frightening to start with. I mentioned briefly that the term citizen science is a bit untypical for our domains. The term crowdsourcing also is not met with a great delight, because our desire to have resources of predictable quality doesn't go well with the word crowd. Actually, if we can involve communities which are interested, knowledgeable, this is good for very specialized tasks. And I agree that a wider participation can help when we have maybe simpler and bigger tasks. But whether people would be involved and would want to contribute, there is obviously another question.
Just as a comment to the last comment or question, do you really see a quality difference between crowdsourcing and citizen science? Because it could also be a question of how to ask questions to the crowd, that quality is not an issue, perhaps?
I said in the beginning that citizen science is when we have a research question and we have an academic guidance involved. Basically, it's a specific type of tasks where crowdsourcing is one of the common methods to actually address these questions. If you can find your crowd or your community and match them to the research question, sometimes this research question might be hidden. But again, this depends on how we work with these communities. If people would love the idea that they contribute to resolving a historical mystery of some sort, they might be more forthcoming.
Is there really a difference between the crowd and the communities? I mean, there is, but if I give away data to the crowd, I obviously only reach the community that is interested in my heritage, in my data. And this combined with very practical questions, how do I, as a memory institution or as an archive, how do I address the right communities? Maybe it's somewhere in the references you gave us, but are there any practical hints to reach the right communities?
You actually will start with the crowd. You will have filters. You will have people who will come, have a look, maybe do one little task and then disappear. So probably we can call a community those people who persevere and continue to give their input. But it will be a huge tail of people who do very little. That's what data from different projects basically show. With the practical tips, the engagement and the constant dialogue with those people who are involved in the task, the feedback, how well they are doing. This is very important, and it takes time, effort. Somebody has to take care of nurturing this relationship. This is one practical tip, and this is not cheap time-wise and effort-wise. So basically, if you just think that you will throw a set of material and no one will have a book, and then miraculously 3 months later it will all be transcribed, that's not going to happen. Maybe our colleagues also from the genealogical project will share their tips.
So one thought perhaps about the difference between a crowd and a community is that a community perceives a benefit or a vested interest in the results of the work. So I can give an example from our efforts in the United States in 2012. Our task was to use citizen scientists or amateur genealogists to transcribe the 1940 U.S. federal census. And it was a very popular project, primarily because people wanted to be able to use the 1940 census in their research. They were excited. That record set becomes available 72 years after it's taken. So 2012 was the year when the 1940 census became available to the public, and there was intense interest, practical interest, in having that record set indexed for one's own genealogical research. So we set up the project so that one could merely choose a particular U.S. state or territory that they wanted to index. We did not allow them to choose a particular county or city or neighborhood. They could only choose a U.S. state. But even with this small amount of project selection or customization, we finished the indexing of 135 million records in 4 months, using about 75,000 volunteers around the world, but mostly in the U.S. So a community is a group that mainly benefits from the results. And so there is a like a practical altruism at work. They want to contribute their time voluntarily, of their own free will, but they want the results for their own uses also. Thank you.